60th annual Westbrook Muster. 60 years. For those of you that were here for the first one, God bless you. That was 60 years ago, 1959. And for the rest of us, thank you for keeping the tradition going. We're going to start things off with our flag ceremony. It's a tradition. All of our volunteers are in the slot with their flag, and they will be marched onto the field by the Junior Colonials of Westbrook. I'm not sure what they're playing, but I'm sure it'll be good. So let's get things started. Junior Colonials, let it rip.
Gentlemen, welcome to our 60th annual muster. This evening, as we place flags from the Westbrook Drum Corps collection around the perimeter of the muster field, a brief history of each flag may be of interest to you. The first flag is the Pine Tree flag. Carrying this flag this evening is Liz Stella of the Westbrook Drum Corps. In 1775, this flag flew over some floating batteries launched in Boston Bay to be used against the British who occupied Boston at this time. In the fall of 1775, General Washington, at his own expense, outfitted 6 ships for use in our coastal waters. As they flew this flag, it became the first ensign of the American Armed Forces in New England, the Pine Tree flag. The second flag is the Moultrie flag. Carrying this flag this evening is Jess Kuchia of the Young Colonials. Colonel William Moultrie's South Carolina militia had hat badges of blue with a white crescent and the word Liberty printed on them. The Moultrie flag was designed from these badges and was flown over Fort Sullivan on Sullivan's Island in Charleston Harbor on June 28, 1776, when the British fleet attacked the Moultrie flag. The third flag is the Bennington flag. Carrying this flag is Francis Kuchia of the Young Colonials. This flag, probably because of its reference to 76, would seem to be one of the most popular and well-known of our early flags. This flag flew over a large depot of military supplies at Bennington, Vermont, which General Burgoyne set out to capture on August 16, 1777. They were met by John Stark and his Green Mountain Boys, This battle undoubtedly contributed to General Burgoyne's surrender at Saratoga, New York, 2 months later. The Bennington flag. The fourth flag is Harris Regiment's flag. Carrying this flag is Natasha Enos of the Quahog. Upon receiving news of the start of the invasion of General Burgoyne in June of 1777, the Vermont legislature appointed Ira Allen chairman of a committee of safety with authority to raise a regiment to defend Vermont. The first company, Captain Ebenezer Allen, commanding, reported for duty at Manchester, July 1777, where the original of this flag was presented to the regiment on July 29th. On August 16th, 1777, Herrick's regiment, with this flag at their head, formed the left of General Stark's line on his attack of Prince Ludwig Dragoon's Regiment of the Army of Braunschweig. Herrick's regiment flag. The fifth flag is the Rattlesnake or Gadsden flag. Carrying this flag is Dodie McGrath of the Westbrook Drum Corps. Colonel Christopher Gadsden, a patriot of South Carolina and a member of the Marine Committee, presented this flag to the Continental Congress in February of 1776. While Congress discussed the possibility, they did not make the rattlesnake the official symbol of the country. On March 17, 1776, Commodore Isaac Hopkins led his ships to the Bahamas to capture large quantities of cannons and supplies. A replica of this flag is said to have been painted on the drums of the new Corps of Marines in this, their first landing. The rattlesnake or gasping flag. The sixth flag is the Grand Union flag. Carrying this flag is John Buzzy of the Kentish Guard. For over 100 years, the colonists had lived under the British flag, or King's colors. Our first national flag, in January of 1776, did not exclude the flag of King George. This flag had 13 stripes to represent the 13 colonies, but retained the King's colors in the canton. This Grand Union flag is also known as the Cambridge flag, as it was first flown at Cambridge, Massachusetts on January 2nd, 1776, when General Washington raised it to a 13-gun salute, inaugurating the beginning of the Continental Army, the Grand Union flag. The seventh flag is the Newbury flag. Carrying this flag is Lisa Williams of the Westbrook Drum Corps. The Newbury, Massachusetts contingent of the Colonial Army first displayed this flag. Here, the designers used a field of green to represent the forest of New England. However, they still felt the connection to their forefathers' flag and retained in the canton the Red Cross of St. George. The Newbury flag. The eighth flag is the Continental flag. Carrying this flag is Jacob Schiller of the Monotony Minutemen. It was appropriate at this time that this, our first flag that did not include any emblem of Great Britain, included a pine tree. The pine tree was repeated on several flags, such as the Bunker Hill flag. It is believed that this flag also appeared at the Battle of Bunker Hill. the Continental flag. The ninth flag is the Rhode Island or Hope flag. Carrying this flag is Bob Mazur of the Kentish Guard. The 1st Rhode Island Infantry Regiment carried this flag. The flag wore a blue anchor in the center of the field, surmounted by the word Hope, the motto of the colony. The banner carried a blue canton on which were painted 13 white five-pointed stars. Since the Rhode Island regimental banner was the only flag in existence at the time, with an arrangement of 13 stars on a blue banner, it appears certain that the Rhode Island flag contributed the stars to the Star-Spangled Banner, the Rhode Island or Hope flag. The 10th flag is the 7th Massachusetts Regiment flag. Carrying this flag is John Morissette of the Cohogs. This regiment was originally organized from existing train bands on October 7, 1636, mustered into active service April 19, 1775, as Gardner's Regiment. In January 1777, it was redesignated the 7th Massachusetts Regiment Continental Line. The regiment is mustered out of Continental service on June 12, 1783. Since that time, it has been called to active duty during each of the wars. The regiment has campaign streamers from the Revolutionary War, the War of 1812, the Civil War, World War I, and World War II, and has received many decorations and presidential citations. The 7th Massachusetts Regiment flag. The 11th flag is the Taunton flag. Carrying this flag is Bill Klimovitz of the Colonial Musketeers. This flag was raised for the first time in Taunton, Massachusetts in October 1774 during the raising of a Liberty flag. This was a new type of Union flag. It consisted of a red field with the Union Jack at the square-shaped canton, and the words Liberty and Union in white letters on the red field, extending across the lower portion of the flag beneath the canton. Taunton also had the distinction of being the only town founded by a woman, Elizabeth Poole, in 1637, the Taunton flag. The 12th flag is the 3rd Maryland Regiment flag. Carrying this flag is P. Tudor of the Colonial Musketeers. On June 14, 1777, one of the routine matters taken up by Congress was a resolution that the flag of the United States be made up of 13 stripes, alternate red and white, that the Union be 13 stars, white on a blue field, representing a new constellation. This did not specify any set arrangement of the stars or the size of the Union. Consequently, anyone who wished to make a flag was free to design it to suit himself. This was the reason for the many different versions that were seen during the Revolutionary War. One of these is the flag of the 3rd Maryland Regiment. Lieutenant John Eager Howard's regiment at the Battle of Cowpen, South Carolina, may have carried it January 17, 1781. The 3rd Maryland Regiment flag. The 13th flag is the Australian flag. Carrying this flag is Christine Short of the Adams Royal Ocean. Australian flag consists of a field of dark blue, red in the case of merchant ships, with a British Union Jack in the canton. In the blue or red field, directly beneath the Union, is a large white seven-pointed star representing the six federated states of Australia and the territories of the Commonwealth. The southern cross, with its five stars, is superimposed on the field near the fly edge. Ivor Evans, a 13-year-old Melbourne schoolboy, designed the flag. His design was selected from 30,000 entries and has been in use since January 23rd, 1901. The Australian flag. The 14th flag is the Swiss flag. Carrying this flag is Virginia Wilco Stafford of the Adamsville Ancients. The history of the Swiss flag is long and complicated. It begins in 1291, when the Swiss Confederation was founded. When the Swiss Confederation consisted of eight cantons, no Swiss flag existed. Each canton had its own flag. Shortly afterwards, they created the Swiss flag, which initially was a triangle with a white cross on a red background. Later, this was changed to a square. In 1889, the official Swiss flag was born. It shows the suspended cross on a red background, and no additional patterns or heraldic figures are allowed. It is the only national flag in the world in the shape of a square, the Swiss flag. The 15th flag is the Star-Spangled Banner. Carrying this flag is Vicki Miarelli of the Sailing Mattress. Here we have the Star-Spangled Banner, one of the few flags to have more than 13 stripes, and the inspiration for Francis Scott Key to write the lyrics of the song, which was to become our national anthem in 1931. The flag was flying over Fort McHenry at Baltimore for the British attack on September 13, 1814. Francis Scott Key was a hostage on the British frigate Surprise during the night. When dawn revealed that the flag was still waving over the port, he composed the words to the Star-Spangled Banner to the music of the British drinking song, Anacreon in Heaven. The Star-Spangled Banner. The 16th flag is the current 50-star flag, with each star symbolizing one of the 50 states in the Union. Carrying this flag is Dominic Cachia of the Civil War Troopers. There before you are some of the symbols of our nation. Researching the history of our flag has revealed, over and over again, a pattern of tremendous personal sacrifice and heroism on the part of the people who carry each of these flags. Our freedom to live under this flag has come at a very high price, paid by all who have defended our liberties in all of the battles of our history. For each of the 50 stars in the flag, there have been thousands who have left their homes and families, many to never return. Tonight, we wish to thank and honor all the men and women who, by their devotion and sacrifice, have made this, our freedom, possible. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand for the flame of our national anthem, the Star-Spangled Banner. Thank you.
I hope you'll join me in thanking Deb Lord for that beautiful walk through American history and all the flag bearers. We're going to dismiss them to join their ranks. Thank you all very much. And in the meantime, the Junior Colonials will reform for their performance.